locked in.
Look at what we have here, folks.
To the only show that matters.
The cream of the crop.
Duke Loves Rasslin.
And there is no one that does it better than
your host.
I have come here to chew bubblegum and kick ass.
The Duke.
And I'm all out of bubblegum.
Now, Buddy Landell, it's so hard for me to stand here looking at a guy hollering my name when last year I spent more alone on spilt liquor than you made. You talking to the Rolex-wearing, diamond ring-wearing, kiss-stealing, wheeling-dealing, limousine-riding, jet-flying son of a gun!
Woo!
It's pretty good, right?
Yeah, you know, you get some energy to it.
Hey, man.
It's still not good. But I appreciate the energy to it.
Well, what's
and I think you appreciated me adding a little enhancement there with a little legitimate
woo.
I did like that. I did like that part there. The woo is definitely something special there.
Well, the problem is though, you didn't finish it. You didn't finish it the way you're supposed to finish it.
What did I miss?
And I'm having a hard time keeping these alligators on the ground.
Woo!
That's how you finish it. It's all about the finish.
Folks, welcome back to Duke Loves Rasslin. I am the Duke. And yes, I do enjoy doing pro wrestling impersonations, and I'm going to keep on doing them no matter what my illustrious co-host, the Boston Bad Boy, Iron Mike Pelosi, says.
And as it turns out, for those of you playing along at home, I've been telling him his impressions are horrible for a year now. It's a year. This is the one-year show.
It is. It is.
I wish I had some game show music to play, but we'd probably get sued.
Da-da-da. You're pretty terrible with that.
Well, you know, but is this the Merv Griffin show?
This is week 52. That's right, the 1 year anniversary of Duke Loves Rasslin. And I'm going to tell you something funny, folks. This show comes from seriously humble beginnings, all right? When I first started the show 52 weeks ago, it was originally called, and I know that a lot of you there were with us from the beginning, it was originally called The Rundown with Duke Loves Rasslin. So I was talking to the Boston Bad Boy, and he was like, you know, it's pretty good, but what's up with the name? Like, it's a long name, and there's too much going on. I'm like, what are you talking about? And then the Boston Bad Boy, for the first and last time in his entire life, gave me some amazing advice. He said, cut the name down, get rid of the rundown, and just call it Duke Loves Rasslin.
After all I do for you, after everything I've done for you, and for this show, that's what you'll give me credit for?
I'm going to give you credit for that.
Oh,
and that's it.
Yeah, that's not enough. It's not enough credit. Because sometimes I'm sitting here, and I want you to get rid of that contract and get out of my life.
Oh,
woo!
Yeah. So
you know, it really does. It's 52 weeks. It does feel like 52 years sometimes.
Hey,
it really does.
And we're just getting started.
Yeah,
brother.
And you know what? We got a good show planned for today. It's a long one, so strap in.
I think we got
a lot of people lined up. We got a lot of things to get through. I got a lot of problems with you people, to quote George Costanza's father.
Oh, you're a mess.
It's going to be a Festivus for the rest
of
us.
Well, listen, you know, the fans have been asking for us to do a longer form show. And I know some of our friends out there, every now and then they do longer form. I know Conrad Thompson and Bruce Pritchard, sometimes they go 2-3 hours, you know. So,
well, I mean, to be fair, they have something to talk about. We don't.
Yeah,
we make it up as we go along.
We just run our mouths there. But listen, seriously, to all of our past guests, I mean, folks like Adrian Gomez of Middle Kingdom Wrestling China, who is literally the first person I ever interviewed on this show, the Black Nature Boy, Scoot Andrews. Scoot, I saw you gave us a shout-out on Twitter. Appreciate that, brother.
Very nice.
We're going to have you come back on the show again real soon, by the way. Sugar and Spice.
Yes.
You know, they finally are wrestling.
Really?
Absolutely.
Wow,
in fact,
they grow up so fast. Well, don't tell the kids.
I told that punk Michael Madrid, the Texas Women's Champion, that I was going to send Duke's Dynasty after them, and Sugar and Spice is part of that. And I know that Brianna, she's already taking a couple of smacks to Micah Madrid's ridiculous self. So, you know, take that. You know, but even Peter Vesey, the Hall of Fame basketball writer,
still one of my favorite interviews in my career. I've interviewed a lot of people in my career outside of this show. Vesey was hilarious.
Oh, he was amazing. Listen.
And nothing, I could talk to that guy every week about his love of Shaq.
Absolutely. Especially right now. Jeez.
I think that was, we talked to him before it was revealed that Shaq believed the earth was flat. And yep. I really think at some point we got to get him back on and see what he
just
thinks
to talk
that.
About that. Well, you know, Vessi is happy to get me off of his bandwagon.
I'm sure,
so.
Yeah. No one hates the fans more than me and him.
Yeah. Susan Tex Green. You know, remember Tex.
Fascinating.
Absolutely.
Fascinating interview. Fascinating life.
And our buddy Steve Do It To It Cox.
Who I believe was the first person we interviewed together.
Yes.
And, you know, you're the wrestling expert. I hate to say it, but I have to say it because it's true. And I was new to doing this show with you. And you said, I'm going to do this thing with this guy, Steve Cox. Oh, he's an old time. Oh, yes. I looked him up. Okay, that's cool. Yeah, you know, guy been around for a long time. And we proceeded to sit through the most incredible hour of interview.
Yes.
That was just, I was just, the eyes rolling back in the in my head. And I really feel like you thought I was going to be like, I'm getting out of here.
Yeah.
Because
I thought I scared you off.
It was an assault on the senses, but a great time. And, and Steve's hilarious.
Great
we
guy.
Love Steve.
And he came back, too.
So, that's right, he came back.
That's which is pretty funny. Shout out to Steve and his family. You know, we love you there, brother. So, listen. You know, once again, thank you to all of our guests and you listeners. We really appreciate you checking in with us every week, and we're just getting started, like I said before. So on this week's show, listen, we have an exclusive interview with none other than the former Ultimate Pro Wrestling standout. We're talking about one half of Hot Lesbian Action. Say that three times fast.
It's a real tongue twister.
I know. Jenny Looney Lane, huh?
You know, I got to say, we did pretty good here that we saved the Hot Lesbian Action for the one-year anniversary show. What better way to celebrate 1 year?
You couldn't write it any better than that. And let me tell you something about Looney Lane.
Yeah.
She has not given any interviews in at least a decade. Like, seriously. You couldn't find. Go ahead and Google Looney Lane and see if you can find an interview with her in the past 10 years. You won't. It hasn't happened, but she's coming on Duke Loves Rasslin. Okay? So we have her there. You know, the Boston Bad Boy keeps talking about some special things going on.
Yeah, I got a few things lined
show.
Up for later in the show.
Okay. All right. Well, you know what? Let's just jump right into Run the Ropes. It's time to run the ropes. Now, folks, normally I give my opinion on the top five stories in the world of professional wrestling. But the Boston Bad Boy says we have something special for the one-year anniversary podcast here.
Well, yes. So, you know, usually the time of the day of the show here, we hear this sound. Mm-hmm. But we have set up the Duke Loves Rasslin voicemail box, which I don't even think you knew about.
No.
And we left it open for our listeners to call in and chime in and see what they had to say about the show.
Oh, that's pretty neat.
Yeah, I went through them, and I grabbed a bunch of them, and I thought that they were pretty good. So I think that maybe we can start. The first one, let me get back on the mic here like a professional. The first one we get is from Big Sam. And here we go.
This is Middle Kingdom Wrestling's strongest wrestler, Big Sam. And I'm here to congratulate my favorite septic, Duke, for his one-year anniversary of Duke Loves Wrestling podcast. I once listened to his nonsense while the kettle was boiling, and I won't make that mistake again.
Whoa.
Anyway, chin up, my friend. Cheerio.
So wait a second. First of all, what did he call me, a septic?
Now let me. Can I just give the disclaimer? I grouped these together. I didn't listen to them. But that is hilarious,
I
actually.
I hope that's like slang for American and not slang for toilet.
He listened to you while he put on the kettle, and he won't make that mistake again.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, that should be the entire slogan for this show. Duke Loves Rasslin. Put us on while you wake the kettle, but don't make that mistake again.
Listen, Big Sam, and he's a big guy, so I'm going to be careful what I say to him. But, you know, hey, I'm glad you listened to the show, pal. I don't know what a septic is. What are you trying to call me there? But thank you, I guess.
Yeah, well, I mean, yeah, you don't you have enough big guys that are going to come kick down your door and even things out. So this
my lawyer is busy.
Thankfully, this guy's in China, right?
Yes.
So you've got some time. So
big sense.
Let's go to the next one from Caitlin.
This is the boss, Caitlin Muggfolk, a.k.a. Sasha Banks' biggest fan. Just wanted to give a shout-out to Duke Loves Wrestling their one-year anniversary. I doubt Sasha would like the show since it's kind of weak.
What?
But you get A for effort, I guess.
All right, hold on a second here, Caitlin.
These are your fans. What do your enemies think of you?
And Caitlin is literally Sasha Banks' biggest fan.
There was a themed wedding.
Yeah, she did a Sasha Banks-themed wedding.
Well, you know, I have to say, if she's such a big Sasha fan, she would know that Sasha would hate this show. So you have to believe that.
All right, Caitlin. I mean, come on. I'm sure Sasha would love the show. Give me a break. Oh, come on. Do you got anything good going on here?
I don't know. Let's see. The next one is from Scotty.
This is Scotty with Wrestler Weekly. I'm here to... What does this say? Okay, I'm supposed to... Okay, I got it. All right. Take two.
What?
Take two?
He messed up.
This is Scotty from Wrestler Weekly, and I'd like to congratulate the Duke.
That's right.
On Duke Loves Rasslin.
That's right.
1 year anniversary. Congratulations.
Thank you, Scotty.
I could not think of a better podcast.
Finally.
Than this one.
That's right.
To celebrate this tremendous 1 year anniversary, and what a tremendous achievement it is.
Thank you, Scotty.
So, Duke, here's to you.
That's right, brother. See, finally we get some positive.
Hey, guys, how was that?
Is he still?
Oh, the podcast got canceled?
No.
Oh, man. Okay, no problem. That thing sucked anyway. I can't believe that they asked me to even do this.
What?
He thinks we're canceled.
Oh, we're still rolling? Okay, well,
yeah,
maybe you can
rolling.
Add that in, because that show is just awful.
Oh, my God.
Duke, he sucks, too.
Are you kidding me?
So,
jeez.
Fans, congratulations.
Boy,
good job, Duke. Keep it up.
Yeah, keep it up after he says I suck, huh?
Well,
give me a break.
Boy,
these are supposed to be our listeners here.
Yeah, listeners and fans. And you know what? I'm always angry at them for not submitting questions. They are totally redeeming themselves with these voicemails.
God.
Oh, I'm having such a good time.
I haven't even started
drinking yet.
Oh, yeah.
I'm saving that for a little later
on
the show.
Yeah, thanks.
So let's see. We're going to move on to, we'll load up. I got number six coming up here.
Oh, boy.
All right. It's from Michelle. Oh, Michelle, a lady.
Hey, Duke, it's All-Star Michelle D here. Just wanted to wish you a happy one-year anniversary on your podcast.
Thank you.
Awesome job. Great first year.
That's right.
But not as great as the Ken Reedy show. But then again, who is? Come on, dude, it's time to step up your game in year two. Nobody wants to see your Z game. You got to bring your A game. But congrats and good luck in the future.
What are you in the double Z game? What's going on?
She's got a lot of nerve. You know that? And I like All-Star Michelle D there, and she's great. You know, she's Michelle the 3D online there. But I'm going to tell you something right now. I don't appreciate her talking about me like that. And the Ken Reedy show is a good show, but come on, Michelle. Come on.
You just can't seem to get ahead here. It's like one step forward, two steps back. And to me, it's so entertaining. I don't even know if these folks are listening.
Any good messages here?
Well,
right?
I give you one more shot here. You know, this one didn't have a label on it, but I thought I recognized the voice, so let's check it out.
Hey, it's Conrad Thompson, co-host of What Happened When Monday with Tony Schiavone on MLWRadio.com. And, of course, the biggest, the baddest, the best show around, Something to Wrestle With, Bruce Pritchard, also available at MLWRadio.com. But today, we're not talking about MLW. We're talking about Duke Loves Rasslin.
That's right.
And, man, I can't believe this show has made it a year. And I can't believe that because it is an awful show.
Whoa,
and take it from me. Whoa. I know what a great podcast is. The Ric Flair Show, Something to Wrestle with Bruce Pritchard, What Happened When Monday, Tony Schiavone. I mean, you know, hashtag humble brag. I've got the top shows in the genre. Meanwhile, this turd of a show, Duke Loves Rasslin, somehow made it a year. Who's listening to this crap?
It is awful.
Duke, stop trying to call me. I'm not going to answer the phone. I'm not going to give you any tips on how to have the number one show. If you want that, you need to check out Something to Wrestle With, Bruce Pritchard, or What Happened When Monday, Tony Schiavone. Not this turd of a show, Duke Loves Wrestling. Good luck getting any butts in the seats for this crap.
Jeez.
He's got a minute and a half. It was a minute and 4 seconds of a promo for Conrad. You say I put myself over? This guy just, et tu, Conrad, stabbed you right in the back.
Well, Conrad.
And put himself over.
First of all, I don't appreciate you leaving a message talking about I should stop calling you, Conrad. Maybe you should pick up the phone, man. I mean, come on. I thought we were friends. I thought we were friends.
The call's coming from inside the house.
And Conrad Thompson is like the man. Like, what? I can't believe this right now.
Yeah, well, you know I think, I don't think we're going to top that one, so I think we should just keep it going.
Did you put them up to this? Tell the truth.
No, I didn't. I strategically released the secret voicemail box number to a select few of people, and those are some of the ones that we got.
You're a piece of work.
You know,
you're a piece of work.
And I'm glad I picked the ones that I did.
Oh,
for me, it was very satisfying.
I'm going to find a way to get you back for this. I don't know what the heck's going on. But anyway, I guess that's run the ropes. Folks, send us a message on Facebook, on Twitter, at Duke Loves Rasslin. Let us know what you thought of those ridiculous messages from people who I thought were our great fans and listeners there. I don't know.
You know, going into a new year, I think we're going to maybe bring that into a feature for the show. We're going to get the mailbox, the voicemail box number up there, and have people, they can leave their voice comments and be part of the show. And if I don't like them, I will, like I do with the written comments, I will squash them and make fun of them. But I think it would be a great new element, give me something new to do in the new fiscal year of Duke Loves Wrestling.
Well, hopefully that you pick some messages that are a little nicer than these.
No, these are perfect. Oh, I want to go in this direction.
Listen, up next, folks, we have our exclusive interview with the one, the only, Jenny Looney Lane.
This is Micah Madrid, the Texas Loons champion, and you're listening to Duke Loves Rasslin.
All right, so Looney.
All right.
We got to talk about this here because I was told something interesting about you. Even before you started wrestling, people that you knew were calling you Looney Lane. So where did that whole Looney moniker even come from?
Okay, so Looney spawned from high school, a group of guys that I grew up with. I was very eccentric. I'm a Leo, so...
Uh-oh.
I was super eccentric, and I loved to dress up, and our school was super spirited, and we always had dress-up days, or I would dress crazy, and I'd always wear something different, but I guess since the guys like to, you know, poke fun at me and tease me, and I get all riled up, they call me Looney, because my last name's Lane, so they call me Looney Lane, and that was, like, my nickname for, like, since I was 14 in high school. And junior, you know, coming up from junior high and high school. And then when I became a professional wrestler, it was like literally, I got a call from Rick Bassman. He's like, we're going to the printer. We're doing a poster. I need a name. And I was like, Looney. Go Looney. Can I cuss? Is that all right?
Yeah, go ahead.
Sure.
I
said Looney. I guess just do it, but it has to be spelled L-O-O-N-E-Y. It always got misspelled through wrestling, but whatever. So... Other than that, that's just my little, that's where it came from. And then when I got, actually it was so funny, when I got into wrestling and I got my first magazine, back when wrestling magazines were cool and awesome, and I got my first magazine and all the guys from back home were like, we gave you that name, we gave you, and I was all like, yeah, cool, I used it. But, like,
everyone wants their piece of the pie, right?
Oh, once anything happens and you're in a spotlight, not like piece of the pie, but yeah, they want their claim, but obviously.
So yeah. You really just covered a lot of stuff, and we want to dig right into your pro wrestling career. So let's start from the beginning of your wrestling career.
Dude, I got to jump in here real quick because we can talk wrestling all day long with Looney Lane. However,
hold on. This is a wrestling show.
I know, but what's more important here, and this is, I was doing some digging before the show.
Uh-oh.
I found out that Miss Lane was on one of the greatest television shows ever made, hosted by King of Syndicated Television, Roger Lodge. You were on Blind Date.
Yes, I was.
And so
yes,
I have, I listen, I have a, I had such a huge appetite for that show because it was always on when, you know, when you're in college and it's just the off hours. That's when that show, they just run like 400 episodes in a row. And you get sucked into this mania. And I always found it fascinating because I couldn't figure out if it was real or if it wasn't, because it was so insane. You'd think, well, this can't be fake.
But
it's
maybe.
Too crazy, but maybe. Yeah.
Well,
so while I have you on the phone, I want to dig into this a little bit, if we may.
So, I mean, I don't know. Can I use wrestling terms?
Sure.
It's okay. It was a work. They totally contacted me. I had two fans at a wrestling show contact me and Rick Bassman at the time. He was my manager, the creator, founder, owner of UPW. Mm. And he said, you know, we'll do it, but it has. We need to incorporate the wrestling. Like, she's not going to do the show. She's not going to incorporate wrestling. Because that's the main reason. And the guy's like, yeah, no. The guys are like, we want her to wrestle a dude in the ring.
What?
And, yeah, so I basically, I mean, and I was all about it back then. I was young. I'm like, sure, I'll do it for sure. You know, so we went interviews for it. And I was like, oh, it's like that dating show. Okay, I get it. And it was funny. The guy and I totally didn't, you know, clash. We totally didn't dig each other at all, and I ended up getting super hammered. But
well, that's another running theme of that show, that people just have gone off the deep end.
This is back when I was young and, you know, crazy, and I was still drinking. I don't drink anymore, but it was super hilarious because I was like challenging, like I totally had to emasculate him in the ring with all my wrestling brothers. Like, I had Samoa Joe there. Joe taught me how to do my finisher, the Hurricanrana, or Looney Karana, I should say.
That's right.
And I had to give him my finisher in the ring. He couldn't even hold me up. It was hilarious. So
they worked rest. They were like, part of your date was going to a gym and doing moves in the ring.
Yeah, basically it was like, if you want to go on a date with our little sister, you got to take her finisher in the ring. And he did. And they're like, all right, you passed, but.
And, yeah. And let me just describe something here. A hurricanrana is when the wrestler wraps, they jump up in the air and wrap their legs around your neck and then flip you over.
Sure, right.
So
they leverage you right
this
over.
This guy should have been, you know, all right with this on a first date,
yeah.
But he couldn't even lift her up, she said. And Looney Lane is not the biggest person in the world. She's actually a pretty small person here, so I don't even understand that.
Yeah, and it was, I felt bad for the guy because he had his own company. That he wanted to, like, he was making a funny T-shirt company at the time that said "Enjoy Vagina," like "Enjoy Coke." That was his
clever.
Local. But he turned out, and I didn't even. And it was funny because he was local here in the South Bay when I was living here, or I still live here. But and I was bartending, and he would show up to. I ran into him at bars, and he's like, "They replay our episodes so much. We should get money. Like, they made me look like a dork." And like,
no, I think he probably did it by not being able to lift you up.
Yeah, that he didn't need any help there.
So I want to just sort of parlay this into the end, which is most of the hysterical, uncomfortable episodes of that show, there was something to do with a hot tub that didn't look very hygienic. Oof. So did you have to endure that?
No.
Oh, good.
I mean, it was bad enough. We had to get him in the ring and make him look like a vagina. And he couldn't wear a shirt. But it was funny. And it was funny. Years later, my girlfriend, she invited me to the erotic show, L.A. Erotica.
Nice.
How funny is this? She takes me to L.A. Erotica. She goes, "This is my friend. He has a T-shirt company.
It's the
We're
guy.
We're just going to wear some shirts and walk around." So what was I wearing? And enjoy vagina.
Look at that.
Around.
Unreal.
It all came full circle.
Now, wait a second. I heard a different I heard a different story, though, because, you know, Colt Cabana, and shout out to Cabana, he's like the godfather of pro wrestling podcast there. Colt Cabana interviewed Frankie Kazarian. Shout out to Kaz. This guy is big time, Ring of Honor, TNA wrestling, you name it. And Kaz said,
stand-up dude.
He's a stand-up dude. And I know that you had trained with him, which we'll get into in a minute. But Kaz said he had a reality TV experience with you as well. So what was he talking about?
A reality TV experience with me? Oh, the first thing that I was on was, remember when they were breaking, telling wrestling secrets, and people were like in the wrestling industry, the real wrestling industry back then. This is like 98.
Oh, yeah. Like the Masked Magician specials.
That's
where
right.
They show you how to do the magic tricks. Yeah.
Yeah. Like, and people were, you know, real wrestling people were getting PO'd. But Rick was into the same thing of like, you know, we're real people. This is what we do, you know? And so the Discovery Channel had a show that they did at the time. It was groundbreaking. It was On the Inside Professional Wrestling, like On the Inside Magicians, On the Inside. And it ended up being the guy now who created all of that is the guy who does Deadliest Catch.
Oh, like, wow.
Yeah, he's amazing. I think it's Tom Beers is his name.
Yeah.
He is amazing. And if I'm getting the name wrong, but they were such great people. And this is in the first beginning of reality. You know, they're doing a documentary on us.
Hmm.
And after they had the girls already picked out, and then they ended up following me, and they're like, okay, you're going to be our girl. Like, we're going to follow your story. And I was really fortunate and very blessed. It was awesome. Like, I was on national television, like, 21 years old. I had my own, you know, I was on a documentary. And Frankie, at the time, we all worked together, and I was smelly. At the time, I was Smelly's manager. I was I coined myself the manager of champions in UPW because I managed him. And then later went on to manage Evolution, which was Frankie and Nova. And they were the tag team champions. And we also got to work against Edge and Christian, which right now you can find on the WWE Network in the Hidden Gem section. And I actually see me give Edge a Hurricane Rana.
Wow. So you just will wrap your legs and flip over anybody who lines up, huh? Is that what's going on?
You know, it's so funny. It was back in the day, like, they're like, when we had a deal with WWF at the time, WWF, not E yet, WWF, we had a deal with them that they would come out and scope out West Coast, you know, talent. Down with us at UPW. So we were like their AAA, you know what I mean? They would come down and they would scout and look for new talent. And this is before, you know, this is before internet blew up, you know, any of that. This is like the very beginning of all that stuff. So there was no, like, nobody had Instagram pages or Facebook pages or MySpace yet, you know, still super instant. We had the fan boards and we would watch people talk crap on fan boards.
Oh yeah. Angel Fire, all that stuff. I remember those days. Yeah.
So I was always the one who had to, because Sasha, my best friend and sister for life, who I met in wrestling, Sasha and I live close to LAX, so we would pick up any talent that was flying in. So WWE would bring out talent once a month, so we'd get one or two names on our card to come out and wrestle and give us a draw. And they would send people out. We had Triple H, we had Edge and Christian, Kurt Angle, you know, plenty of people come out and work our shows. So they sent Sasha and I to pick up Edge and Christian. And when we picked them up at LAX, we're talking, and Sasha and I had already met Edge when we did our dark match at the Anaheim Pond. Mind you, first girls to come out as valets for a dark match, because we were also being looked at as talent, because this is like the infancy of like pushing the girls. So, anyways, Edge is in the car, and he's like, who are we working against tonight? And I go, oh, you're working against me and my tag team Evolution with Frankie Kazarian and Nova. And he's like, cool. He's like, well, what's your finisher? And I'm like, the Looney Karana. He goes, okay, you'll give me that tonight. And I was like, and we're just talking in the car. And I was like, listen, and I knew my role as a woman in the industry. I was like, you need to wait till we get to the actual venue and talk to the guys. You know what I mean? And obviously, I'm sure they were going to kind of go with what, you know, the top card stars wanted. But I didn't want to make it look like, hey, Edge, can I give you my Hurricane Rana tonight? Put me over. You know what I mean? It wasn't like that. It was like, oh, you're going to do that tonight. So when it came to doing it, all the guys, like, when we were in the meeting, like, you know, talking down our match and figuring out what we're going to do, and they're like, you better nail that.
Don't embarrass us.
Yeah. Don't make us look like a bunch of assholes. So it turned out it was great. But I mean, looking back now at it, I mean, it was still super new. I mean, we're all our own worst critic, and I'm like, oh, that was kind of shitty. But in the moment when you're doing it, it was fucking perfect.
Wow.
You know, so.
So wait a second. Because I blame the Boston Bad Boy for this. Because he threw me off here where he had you talking about reality TV.
You're supposed to be professional here.
No, you had us talking about reality TV, and then, you know, Looney went over half her career.
Can I just say something? What? She went over half her career. It was it was very interesting. If it was up to Duke, he'd be sitting there reciting like encyclopedia pages about wrestling.
Give me a
break. That's how he spends his time.
Give me a break.
He searches old Wikipedia articles about obscure wrestlers, and it relaxes him.
So what?
Thank you.
I'm a nerd.
Yeah, that's what he does.
Yeah.
So when we have someone on here, interesting.
I'm happy I got picked.
No, it's not that. We like to have interesting people on. Otherwise, I might jump out a window. I insist on having good people on this show, and he just wants to go on and on and on and on.
That's right. So I'm going to go on and on and on now. Let's dial it back for a second. So you are somebody who you and your family, you were born in Nevada. Is that correct?
Born and raised Las Vegas, Nevada, one of the few that can say it.
I was going to say, I've never come across anyone who actually was born and raised in Nevada. There's a lot of people who live there, but nobody's from Las Vegas.
Isn't it Nevada?
It's Nevada.
Thank you.
I love your accent. You can say whatever you want.
Do I have an accent?
You have an accent.
No, both of you do.
Oh, get out of here.
No. Duke does.
Yes, thank you. I have no regionalism. I am a radio professional.
Oh, give me a break.
I don't talk like I just walked off the set of The Departed.
Put some soap over.
The set of The Departed.
Put some soap over. This is what I got to deal with over here.
Yeah, you should be so lucky.
Yeah. So you were born and raised in Las Vegas, and then you moved to California.
Yep, left when I was 19.
Now, because I did some research. Like the Boston Bad Boy says, the Duke likes to do his research. But I was a fan of yours anyway. You actually were dating a guy who was the real pro wrestling fan. Is that correct?
Yes.
And he introduced you to the owner and, the lead guy at UPW, Mr. Rick Bassman, who you've mentioned numerous times already there. Now, this is what I find interesting. And I've heard this from other female wrestlers before as well. You have the boyfriend who's the mark, who's really into the wrestling and X, Y, and Z, but you're the one that ends up in the business.
Yeah, right.
And I was the mark myself. The way Chris and I met, it was Chris Bell. He's a filmmaker, bigger, stronger, faster, and Prescription Thugs.
Oh, wow. Yeah, Prescription. Great, great movie. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, so his brothers were professional wrestlers. His brother, Mad Dog Mike Bell, God rest his soul, he's passed away. Mad Dog was Chris Bell's older brother. So he was a huge wrestling fan. We were in Hermosa, and I overheard him. It was one night. So I had a group of friends that we were all living in the valley at the time out here. Now, this is over the hill and it's an hour away from Hermosa Beach. And everyone's waiting for me to drive the car of everyone down to out to Hermosa Beach. So I'm like, there's this great bar we need to go. You'll guys love it. Called Sharky's. They're like, okay, but we had to wait because it was that one time they did Monday Night Raw on a Saturday night. So I made them all sit and watch wrestling, and they're like, what the front? Like, seriously, we have to watch this? And then I'm like, don't make fun of it or you can leave my house.
Nice.
So we get to the bar, we're standing in line, and there's like a really long line to get into this bar, and then there's like this small VIP line. So I look, and I'm looking at the doorman, and I hear Chris talking to his other doorman saying, all right, let's get these jabronis out of here and like we'll move these guys over. And I was like, wait a minute, did you just call those guys jabronis? And he's like, yeah, what do you know? And then I was like, what? And then all my friends went, seriously, bro, can you just let us in? Because she's going to go off and start talking about wrestling.
Nice.
So he let all my friends in VIP, and then I stayed at the door and talked wrestling with them all night. And we ended up becoming best of friends and then dating. And that's, how I, his brother Smelly moved out here, or Mark Bell, moved out here to California as well to get into wrestling. And so he just started with this small group, UPW. UPW just, I was there from the beginning when we were still wrestling in our gym and having shows in our gym. And then we went and moved to an actual venue called, at the time it was called the Galaxy Theater.
Wow.
So, that's how Chris and I got to, we also got another pretty big guy into wrestling too. But
well, hold on to that.
Well, I was going to say that was a much more interesting story than any time I've ever been out with Duke, and he starts talking wrestling too much. You know, for you, when the wrestler does it, like, oh, it opens doors. Anytime I'm stuck with Duke in a public place and he decides to pull this, oh, I know wrestling, we're left standing by ourselves, cocktails in hand, going, and I'm like, what are you doing here? You got to know your audience.
Are you kidding me? You know that's not true.
You need to know. She knew her audience and got into the club.
Listen,
you botch it.
Hey, you got some beautiful woman who knows about wrestling. Of course, she's going to get the VIP.
No, don't make it a sexist. This is not sexist. That's sexist.
Let's stay on track.
She knew her audience. Yeah. You do not. Right. So let's move it on.
Give me a break. So when you started with UPW, because like you said, you were there from the beginning, basically. Who were some of the people that were there with you? Who were some of the other folks who were breaking into wrestling at the time?
Oh man, Tom Howard was our trainer. Just Insane, the Hardcore Kid, Mad Dog Mike Bell. There's so many. The Ballard Brothers are awesome. They've been wrestling for a while, why can't I remember his name?
Samoa Joe.
Samoa Joe is one of my. He came later, but yeah, he a little bit later. But Samoa Joe was one of Joe and I ran around together everywhere when we were younger. Like, we did everything together.
Wow.
That was my BFF. along with some other people. But, yeah, what other guys are there?
I know John Cena was there.
Chris Daniels.
Christopher Daniels, the Fallen Angel, the Ring of Honor champion.
Are you kidding me? He is by far, that guy is the most stand-up, awesome. Every single person I've worked with is awesome. The Big Swag, he was with us. King Favi, great wrestler. There's too many to list. Frankie Kazarian.
Yep.
Nova.
Yep. Now, John Cena was there too as the prototype. Is that correct?
Yes, and John Cena.
So
that's who Chris and I got into. Basically, Chris and I, after we started, I started wrestling and training. Chris and I went to the gym, and John was working the nutrition stand, and we're like, dude, you have to come to wrestling. And then after that, he was my road dog. Like, we did, I'd pick him up for practice I drove him to practice. Practice is like an hour away in Huntington Beach. So I'd pick him up every Saturday, Sunday. We had to go train. And then when we moved to El Segundo, our gym moved to El Segundo. I would drive him to El Segundo. I mean, That was my road dog. Him and John and Joe were like my road dogs. I mean, we traveled together, but we did a lot of independent shows together, like long road trips, where it's like I'm the only girl and I'd have to drive this huge excursion of all these big wrestlers and they're falling asleep. And then John's in the front seat with me, freestyling with me so I can keep awake. Like, that's my dog.
Marky Bark.
I'll still never understand the John Cena hip-hop album. I just don't
know.
Dude,
it went platinum. It went platinum.
Freestyle like no other.
That's right.
It's just funny to me.
I said to Bruce Pritchard, I'm like, you ever heard that guy rap? Listen to that guy rap. And then he, of course, was rapping in the freaking, I guess the story, he told me he was rapping in the, you know, in the backstage with the guys in the locker room and, you know, because he was very young. And then I guess he was on a plane one day and Stephanie McMahon was like, I heard you can rap about anything. And I was like, and he was like, yeah, I can. And she goes, rap about this can of tuna fish. And he rapped for 20 minutes about tuna fish.
Unbelievable.
And they're like, okay, then they were like, that's going to be the new gimmick.
That's the gimmick.
Well, it's funny to me because you always have actors who want to be singers or singers who then turn to actors. And it's always kind of strange. Sometimes it works. Sometimes it doesn't. Eddie Murphy comes to mind. You know, he had the one hit single.
Nice.
But it's so funny that something professional.
Party all time.
Professional wrestling is so far away in a way, at least back in the day, from hip hop. It's just like that they intersected with a guy like John Cena who looks like a G.I. Joe is just the funniest coincidence.
Listen, that was meant to be.
And right now, he would totally go over now.
Oh, yeah.
Now.
Please, he would go three times platinum.
Maybe he could play Eminem in the sequel to 8 Mile.
Oh, give me a break. What is wrong with this guy?
This time, there's no there's nowhere to run.
You see this smart guy over here.
John Cena is Eminem in 9 Mile.
So you had all these folks who, and you all in your own rights, had some great careers and made it big time, et cetera, et cetera. But we got to know some dirt here, all right? We got to get into some dirt. Now tell the truth. Was there any dating going on with anybody around that time there? You know, is he...
No, I was just dating Chris, and then I broke up with him. But yeah, no dating.
Wow,
keeping business from pleasure separate.
That's what it is.
We
she laughed at that. She's not 100% convinced that that's how it went.
Wait a second.
We've been super tight through the years. I'm still up until John started seeing Nikki. We still would text every. You know, we're still friends, but you know. He's a one woman man and she's a crazy Latina, so
you don't want any part of that. Her sister's crazy too.
I don't want my friendship to be misconstrued as anything for sure.
That's right.
I feel like Prince of Darkness, Vince McMahon, has gone so far above his purview to commingle the wrestling world with the reality TV, with these people's real lives. If you got sucked into that vortex, there may be no escaping. Because these people could not escape either.
No, exactly. And it's it's a good story to tell everyone at the bar. You know, I love that guy. We all came up together and, you know, people are like, oh, wrestling, like, yeah, John Cena. Oh, yeah, that's my homeboy. Like, you know,
nice.
I've been to the house in Florida before it became the mansion. Then it became the mansion. The pool, like, dear friend, because I knew that guy when he was living in a single bedroom apartment in Inglewood.
You hear that, Cena? Huh?
Oh boy,
she made you, son. You hear that?
Oh boy. Yeah, Duke's just sitting here.
No, make. I mean, obviously he's a beast on his own. But
He is.
He's a stand-up dude, and he finally put an effing ring on it. I watched it on. I mean, that would have been my dream proposal, being a wrestling nerd. And when I saw Stephanie McMahon and Triple H get married at the Staples Center in the ring, I was like, "Oh my god, that's what I want."
Oh man,
you know, I gotta say, Vince, I can't tell you guys apart sometimes. Duke spent his week watching old Ric Flair promos, so he's dying to cut a promo on someone. Please do not give him the opportunity to, because I have to sit in the room with him, and you could just hang up. So I think before he gets any more riled up here, we should continue.
Listen, I'm going to be complimentary of John Cena, which, you know, I don't do that too often, because he's a Massachusetts guy like we are. Uh-huh. He's from West Newbury, which is nowhere near Boston, by the way, folks.
West Newbury.
Which is nowhere near Boston, but still, John Cena is one of ours, so... Shout out to Cena and congratulations and all the stuff there.
I mean, all you Boston boys, I'm thinking about it. I look at it and I'm all like, the Marky Mark,
Don't even get me started. If she says Ben Affleck, I'm hanging up the phone.
That's it.
I'm not recognizing that guy. He has a horrible tattoo on his back.
Wait, he has a back tattoo? Huh? Wait a minute.
All right, we just went off the rails.
I have to talk about this. You always talk about your arch nemesis, Roman Reigns.
Yeah.
My arch nemesis in life is Ben Affleck, because I just think he's awful. He has a back tattoo, and how did I not know this?
Oh my god! And I just found this out because I just saw it. Like, I saw them. They were interviewing. Of course, they were interviewing Jennifer Lopez.
Sure. Who we love.
Fellow birthday sister, August 16th.
Nice.
We are super Leos, along with Madonna and a couple others. But she, they did an interview on it, and she told him not to do it. She's like, I don't like it. And
does it say Gili?
No, it's like a big dragon.
Of course it is. That's what I'm telling you about. This guy has no creativity.
Leave him alone.
He won an Oscar for allegedly screenwriting Good Will Hunting. And this guy is so creative. He got a dragon tattoo.
Listen,
that right there should explain everything you need to know about Ben Affleck.
Any man who was able to be with Jennifer Lopez is a man that should be at least given a thumbs up. So stop.
Get out of here.
Just stop it.
He should never play Batman. He's ruined Batman, my childhood hero.
It's the halfway thumb for me. Like,
halfway thumb. Well, something's better than nothing.
Sorry,
but listen,
I hate to say, but Casey Affleck, now that boy can act too.
Nah, I'm not a fan of his.
I'm not a fan of his either.
Yeah. Well, we don't want to go too far on these Boston guys. This is about Looney Lane.
What do you have against Boston guys here?
Well, give me a... We're real Boston guys.
What do you want to know? Keep going. What another question?
I was just waiting for you to get start talking about how you love all Boston guys and you think we really sound really nice.
Stop it.
I'm from the West Coast.
Mm-hmm.
And I love where I live. Anyone who can treat me with respect, doesn't matter where they're from. That's all it matters.
Well, I got to say something. Have you been to Boston?
Of course.
A long time ago. I was there for a little bit.
Sure. So I remember the distinctly I went to California. I went out to visit friends, and we went to a bar. We were in the Bay Area, and went to a cool bar. And I go up to the bar to get a drink, and I'm standing at the bar, and this beautiful blonde is standing. She sidles up next to me, waiting for a drink as well. And she turns to me, she says, "Hi," and I didn't know what to say because that doesn't happen in Boston. Everyone here is miserable. And there is no social interaction. A woman saying hello in a bar, I had to wait till I was like 28 years old for that to happen.
Well, speak for yourself.
Oh, please. Get out of here. Get out of here. No one's talking to you now, never mind at a bar.
Please. Looney, don't listen to this guy, please.
I like California people is what I'm trying to say.
Yes, me too.
Thank you.
And Vegas people.
We try to be nice.
That's right. So wait a second. We might as well just, because when I started talking to some of our fans and let them know that we were going to be interviewing Looney Lane, of course, everybody brought up one major thing.
Hot lesbian action.
That's exactly what they brought up. So we got to hear the story behind this. What is up with the hot lesbian action thing? Tell us, please.
I got a phone call from Bassman, and he was like, "Hey, we already talked to Sasha."
Please qualify that, because I don't want anybody to think you're talking about Sasha Banks. You're talking about Savvy Sasha.
Savvy Sasha. Right. Yes, not Sasha Banks, who, by the way, I mean, oh my gosh.
We love her.
Both girls. Oh my God. Okay, I can't wait to talk about that right after this. Okay, so.
Oh boy. This is going to be nerd fest here on Sasha Banks. The two of you, I might have to leave and get a drink.
No. So my girlfriend, Savvy Sasha, she we worked together, we wrestled together, I met her through wrestling, and she's still one of my best friends. So. Rick called. He said, "I just talked to Savvy. She's in. Are you in for Monday Night Raw?" And I go, "Absolutely. What are you talking about?"
Nice.
Oh, God. Like, I'm 23 years old. I'm like, "You can put anything." I'm like, "Yes, I'll do it." So we had no idea what the deal was. Sasha knew. And then I found out, and they're like, you know, we had no idea until we got to the venue that we were going to be in Braun County. And
something that might have been brought to your attention, yeah. I think.
You know what I mean?
Just
like,
don't tell
they're
them.
They're like, "Hey, bring," you know, at the time it was like, "Bring your like outfit that you'd wear to go out." Well, we dressed dope in California. You know what I mean? We dressed really nice. We dressed cool back then. And when they saw our style, they're like, "No," because we have to like get the whole broad spectrum. Oh no, they just wanted us to dress like sluts. So we didn't have that. So we were in the middle, I think we were in Iowa. I can't even remember. We're in the middle of nowhere. They had to send. They're like, "Do you have matching bra and panty sets?" And we're like, "What? No, what? No." And so we made it work. They would send someone out to get bra and panties for us. Of course, they give Sasha a thong, and they give me a freaking G-string. And wow. My ass was a hard camera.
I assume it was men that went shopping.
Mm.
What?
I assume they sent men to do this shopping, which is why this is what happened.
They probably sent like some assistant guy or girl. Right. I don't know.
Best job.
So, mind you, the night before when we flew in, I ended up getting food. I got food poisoning that morning.
Oh no!
So, nobody knows behind the scenes. I was literally vomiting on the floor. I was in a ball on the floor all day.
You're ruining the whole thing here now. Just so you know.
I'm so sorry. But I'm sick to my, it was so funny. We get there, and this is the early days when the back, like the women's dressing room was super small. You know, China and them were still on the road, I think. And I remember it was Terry Reynolds was there, and Stacy Keebler, and Trish Stratus. And it was like, they moved us. They put us in the women's locker room. Then they moved us to another place. And then they moved us upstairs to some back room. Like, they moved us three times because we were not the in-house talent. We were, you know, hired out talent. And what they used to do back in the day for the Godfather's girls and stuff like that, they would just go to a strip club the night before. "Hey, you want to make $100 on TV?"
Well, they'd go pick up Ric Flair anyway. Might as well go to the strip club.
So, back then, when us being females being brought in, they're probably thinking, "Oh, they probably just hired these two chicks last night from a strip club," not knowing that talent called West Coast and brought in two of the best females, because we were the first girls to be looked at as managers, as valets in the dark match at the Anaheim Pond.
But you were actually wrestlers too, which is the interesting part about the whole
wrestlers.
Thing.
Yeah. We were trained wrestlers, but there was so much. It was still new for women to get in the ring. So it was still a novelty, basically. Not a novelty, but you know what I mean? It was still, that's how we got introduced to it. And then when I went out as a valet, the first show I had, the WWF scouts were there, and they're like, get her in the ring, get her to start training, because we need her to train.
Of course. So, wait. We don't want to, we got to stick to this thing here, though. How did they introduce the HLA to you, though? So they went out and they got the bra and panties.
Oh, yeah.
You're thrown up all over the place.
Nobody knows. I'm like, I have food poisoning. They're like, hey, it's time for you guys. We're going to take you out to the ring. Go get suited up. Thing in the ring.
Yeah.
And I'm like, I looked at Sasha. I was like, I'm going out. I went out in a wife beater and some velour sweats barefoot. We walk out, and I'm like, I'm shaking Vince McMahon's hand, trying not to throw up on him while I'm in the ring. And they're like, "That you're ready?" And I go, "Well, you're gonna have us in bra and panties. What else am I gonna I'm fine. What do you want me to do?" And I'm trying like just to hold my composure and be professional. And we had it all planned out that I was supposed to get a super kick to the face, like a Shawn Michaels super kick, and then Savvy gets picked up, she gets thrown, they hook her for a fireman, they give her a fire, they drop her, and then they put me on top of her in the 69 position for a Samoan splash. And that was the whole 3-minute warning. So we had they went over it with us a million times. They were so nervous about this whole spot because they did the whole Monday Night Raw about it. So because they were countering Billy Gunn, and having a commitment ceremony. Chuck and Billy.
Mm-hmm. So the whole segment was built around this hot lesbian action, and they get these two beautiful girls to come out, and you're in the middle of the ring. You actually kissed each other. And then these two massive Samoans come out, 3-minute warning, and they end up squashing the both of you.
Dude, they nailed me. Okay, first off, that was television magic. We never kissed, but my girlfriend's a trained actress. So
see that? Nice.
Anyway, she's like, I'm not kissing you on national television. You're my best friend, and I love you, but I'm not kissing you. And I go, and me, I'm like selfish. Young and dumb, and I'm like, I'll do anything. She's very professional. I mean, they were so nervous. They were running lines with us. And I'm standing, I turn around and I'm like, 3 minute. And he's like, 3 minute. And I turn around and I get a size 13 straight to my gut. And boom. I got shot across the ring.
Boom.
I was like, oh, this wasn't a super kick to the face. I'm not even going to. And the funny thing is they're like, when he gives you the super kick, we need you to dead sell. Just don't move. And I'm like, of course, like a chick gets knocked out by a dude. Like, yeah, you got to play dead. That's the whole point. So
this sounds like some half remembered Vince McMahon, like lesbian dream that he had one time. And he said, he woke up one morning and said, these two women are in the ring and it's getting interesting. All of a sudden these giant Samoans come out. Like it just, and you're not prepared. You're not prepared. You're getting a kick to the gut where you're not expecting it.
These dumb lesbians are going to come on TV and, and be hot and sexy and get the crowd chanting, HLA, HLA, and then boom.
And then we squash them. Yeah.
And all you can hear is King saying, puppies!
Yeah. Jerry King Law saying puppies.
Chanting, like, they had to get the real EMTs for me and the fake ones for her.
Unbelievable.
I couldn't breathe. Like, I couldn't breathe from the kick. And then they threw me on top of her.
This is insane. And squashed you.
Splash,
yeah.
I got killed again.
Unbelievable.
So, as they're rolling me out, I have a neck brace on and I'm in my bra and panties and you hear, HLA puppy, show us your tits.
Oh, like, my God.
You know, you got to love Middle America, right?
Yeah.
I mean, you just...
Yeah. Welcome to pro wrestling.
We're like in Iowa.
Right. Like, at the Corn Dome in Iowa, yeah.
Yeah, we're in the local college dome and just getting,
So
then after that, it was funny. Ed was pissed. He's like, I told you that you should have told me you're working against those guys. They work hard. And then Tommy Dreamer was pissed. He came in as I was being rolled back. He's like, are you okay? Are you okay? And I was like, no, I'm fine. I got my breath now. I'm good. He's like, what the F was that? And I'm like, I know. So, like, I had a few guys come to my aid and defense. But, hey, it worked. Everyone loved it, even though my big horse's ass was on hard camera and a freaking G-string. It's all good.
And it lives forever.
My dad was like, why didn't you call me and tell me it was your big deal on WWE? And I go, well,
don't ever look at it.
I'd already been on Sunday Night Heat with Val Venus. And I go, no, Dad, I'm good. I didn't want you to see it. And he goes, well, I know you and Sasha aren't lesbians. I know it's acting. And I was like, no, dude, my ass was on television.
Poor guy.
Now, did they try to continue this gimmick?
No, it was just a one-time thing. That's why it's so famous.
That's a lie. Anytime you type in HLA or lesbians, and they always bring in stuff that happened after us. And it was such a big deal. Now, this was like 2001.
Take it on a life of its own.
Yeah.
It was such a big deal that, like, sponsors were going to pull from WWF. Like, they were so appalled that they did that back then. Because this was back in the, the X, back in D-Generation X.
That's right.
Back in the real raw, you know. And so when Linda McMahon was running for, Congress?
She was running for Congress. That's right.
He's like, oh, you're going to support this woman? They do this kind of stuff to women and they're pulling up stuff like our HLA segment. So, the rights that Vince and them had, because they own everything, they had that pulled off the internet for a long time. I couldn't even find it.
Don't worry. We found it, and we're gonna put it on the Duke Loves Rasslin Facebook page, folks, so everyone can relive that infamous moment in wrestling history.
I will say, it turns out that a lot of this late night research that Duke does is on female wrestlers and their various moves and videos that he can find. So I don't know what's going on.
What? Give me a break.
He says it's for scholarly pursuit. I believe him. Far be it for me to say.
We're beautiful beings.
That's right.
You tell them. So Loons.
Everybody wants to see if a nip's going to slip or something.
Nice. So you've done everything from, you had your reality TV moments, you trained with some of the biggest stars in the history of pro wrestling, and you even had one of the greatest moments, one of the most well-known moments in the history of pro wrestling. If fans want to reach out to you, because I got to say this, and when you and I first started talking, I said this to you too, you kind of dropped off the face of the mat. You went back to just being a regular citizen, one of the biggest kick-ass bartenders around.
Thank you.
But it's interesting, though, that when you left the business, you really left. So if some of the fans want to reach out to you and just say, hey, Loons, what have you, we miss you, et cetera, what's the best way they can reach you?
Oh, they can get me through, like, my Facebook or my Instagram, SB Loons. And my Facebook, I'm just Jenny C. Lane. I used to put Looney on there, but I had it as Jenny Looney Lane, but because it's my nickname out here. Everyone in the South Bay where I live in Southern California, Redondo Beach, everyone knows me as Looney. It was also when it was my wrestling name, I became a bartender out here, and it was my work name. Mm. So,
which it's fitting because that was also your nickname in high school, too. So it's just funny how that works out there.
Yeah, so it's still my name.
Now, if bookers want to have you come out for some conventions or signings or anything like that, is that something that you would be potentially interested in the future?
Yeah, I mean, that would be cool. I mean, I obviously don't have the money to travel. I live a really simple life out here. I gave up bartending 2 weeks ago.
Oh, no.
Oh, come on.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's going to be only for private events.
Oh.
So, I'll be picking up shifts at my, the people that I started bartending with when I was a kid. They still have another location, so I get shifts every now and then. But I have my own business. I run have my own cleaning business.
Oh, excellent. Actually, plug the business. How can folks get in touch with you if they want to get some cleanings done out there in the West Coast?
I would say just through Facebook, private message me, through Facebook. And it's still super new. I've only been doing it a year, mainly for friends and family. And, yeah, just it'd be awesome to see it grow. Just DM me.
Give us the Facebook again one more time. What's the Facebook address?
It's Jenny C. Lane. And if you do, like, you can look up the real Jenny Lane. Oh, no, the real Jenny Looney Lane.
Perfect. And we'll put that on Facebook for all you listeners out there. We'll make sure that we tag Looney in all these different posts that we're going to do for the week. So you can get in touch with her if you need some cleaning, if you have some signings, or if you just want to say, hey, we really appreciate your contribution to the wrestling business. Because that was the whole point of bringing you on.
A private bartender?
Yeah, there you go. There you go.
What do you do on Thursday nights at around 6 o'clock?
Give me a break.
Could we fly out?
Yeah. Listen to this.
Because I need a drink when I'm sitting here with him.
I would love to come sit in the studio with you guys. You're going to have to bring me out there, and I'll have to bring my warm clothes. They'll actually get me a reason to wear my winter stuff.
Oh, so it's going to be a winter thing. Because it's getting warm now, finally.
It's so funny. I had a radio show, too, with the Big Swag and Samoa Joe.
Yes, you did. I remember that show.
Wrestling 101, and I was a female voice, and I was always late.
Yeah, and that's why Joe and John Cena would pick on you and beat you up
we would go, like, that's the thing. I would pick up John, and Joe, John, and I, we always hung out, and it was so fun. Those guys are my boys.
See?
I haven't talked to Samoa Joe forever, but like I said, John and I still kept in touch.
We're going to make sure those guys reach out to you, too.
And I was going to say, you can be proud that you never made it to the blind date special Hot Tubs of Horror.
Oh my God.
So you know, that's a good thing. Because there are some people who are probably still dealing with some residual medical conditions from
Looney, we're going to have you back on the show again in the not-too-distant future because we still have so much to talk about. Seriously.
Oh, my God, I love it. Sorry, I go on tangents. I can talk a lot.
No, you're fine. Her name is Jenny Looney Lane. We appreciate you.
Thank you. I appreciate you guys. Thanks for hitting me up.
Man, Looney Lane, she's something else.
Boy, I'm a little worn out after that one, to be honest.
I'm telling you, bro.
But she likes the Boston guys, so maybe she'll come back on the show.
All right, don't get you. Every time.
Get a vibe.
It's like we had April Hunter on, and you got, you know, you put on the
listen,
the
don't
extra
be mad.
Shaved.
Like, don't be mad because I have sort of a je ne sais quoi.
Listen, Looney Lane is not interested in you, pal. Okay?
I didn't say she was interested in me.
Yeah.
I said she's interested in people from our town.
Yeah.
Of which one I am.
Give me a break.
Did you like that Sean Spicer round?
I know, yeah. Good job, Spicy.
Circular use of the word.
Good job, Spicy. Well, listen, folks, up next, the Boston Bad Boy promises something special for Ask Duke.
It's always something special when I do it.
But before we get to any of that, as you know, Boston Bad Boy, it's the one-year anniversary Duke Loves Rasslin.
We've been saying it all night.
Yeah. So, in celebration of this, okay, we have one of the greatest moments, not only in podcasting history, but in food history. Mm-hmm. Okay? Now, I told you that the great folks over at Barnyard Cheese, they've been working tirelessly for months and months to come up with something new.
Okay.
Okay? But not just any new item here.
Yeah.
We're talking about something special enough, it actually has my name on it.
Oh, my God. And I've been arguing that's the most insane thing I've ever heard. The fact that anyone would name anything after you, even a sandwich, is absurd.
Well, listen.
On so many levels.
It is not. Stop it right
now. It's a waste of good lunch meat.
Give me a break. Listen, without further ado, Barnyard Cheese Man of the Hour. Okay, I'm talking about the sandwich expert, Double D Dave Davis, unveiled to the world the Duke sandwich.
All right. Hey, guys. Coming at you live from Barnyard at work right now. And we're talking about a new sandwich we're calling the Duke.
Oh, my God.
We're going to go with jamón serrano, a little manchego, a little membrillo paste, some light olive oil, and on a baguette. And that is the Duke.
Wait a minute. Woo! Wait. Double D, I gotta say something. All those things you just said right now, those are made-up things, and you're just trying to be nice to Duke because he's been bothering you about this sandwich.
Stop
you can admit it. You can admit it to me, and the fans will understand because we know how Duke is. He's been insisting on this sandwich. He thinks he deserves it, and you're just trying to run a sandwich shop. And you made this up just to placate him.
Oh, it's not just Duke. I can't tell you how many people come in asking when we're getting a Duke sandwich.
Oh, get out of here.
You see that?
Get out of here.
You see that? And listen, all you great listeners out there, you can make it even extra special. Ask for a little red wine vinegar for a little dip.
Oh,
okay.
The two of you here.
A little dip.
You know, Double D, it's the first time I'm talking to you. We've talked about the shop a lot. We've talked about you and all the great stuff, the menu. It always makes me hungry. But I'm losing a little bit of faith here.
Stop.
I'm losing a little bit of faith.
Stop.
But here, I have a great idea. I have a great idea for the Boston Bad Boy sandwich. Simple.
All right.
It's a knuckle sandwich. Okay? It's a knuckle sandwich, and that's all. You can decide what's on there. Maybe like a pork knuckle.
Give me
I don't know.
Break.
Something good.
Don't listen to him, Double D. Listen, if folks want to try the most amazing sandwich in the history of all sandwiches, where can they find this? Where's the address down there?
We're at 168 Avenue B between 10th and 11th in the Lower East Side, Alphabet City.
And what about that website?
Website, a simple barnyardcheese.com.
That's right. His name is Double D Dave Davis. Thank you very much, my friend, for putting together the Duke sandwich.
Oh, thanks for having me on, guys.
Hey, everybody, it's Nick Hausman from WrestleZone and Bischoff on Wrestling. And if you're looking for news you can use, news that'll leave a bruise from the world of pro wrestling, be sure to stay tuned to Duke Loves Rasslin.
All right, Boston Bad Boy. Listen, this has been an excellent one-year anniversary show.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's funny. So far, we've come in 1 year, and to have you be still so mediocre in your
God.
Understanding of wrestling Give and the understanding of the business, it's just, you know, there's a curve to everything. So you know, I think, well, someday I'll get you there.
It's just what amazes me is that we're supposed to have all these positive vibes, you know, great things going
this
on.
This is reality, brother. This is reality.
You're just a piece of work, man. So you've been talking up this special thing that you have for Ask Duke.
Yep.
All right? And,
yep.
And you know I love a great gift.
Well, you're going to love this one because for you, I got the man who loves all people.
Ric Flair?
Direct from Texas, Mr. Rudy Boy Gonzalez. Rudy, you there?
I'm right here. Let me just say one thing before we get this off the ground. Dukester, congratulations for completing your whole year on this miserable podcast. But I myself have an anniversary gift from you from the one and only women's champion here in Texas, Micah.
Duke, this is Micah, the Texas Women's Champion. I know you're surprised to hear from me right now, but I am more surprised that your show has been around for a year. Wow, truly amazing. Considering all the trash talk that you do, I hear your podcast, I see you on Facebook and Twitter, hiding behind a computer, bad-mouthing me, the Texas Women's Champion. So you know what? Next time I do see you, I will destroy you.
Whoa.
But in the meantime, enjoy your 1 year anniversary for now. I got two things for you. Do not mess with Texas, and definitely do not mess with me, the Texas Women's Champion.
Wow, Rudy, that's the gift that keeps on giving. Can I tell you, having to sit in this room with Duke and just to have you come on and Micah come on and really just lay it out there, it's a beautiful thing. If only you could see the look on Duke's face right now.
She said, I have two things. You. I thought she was going to say, suck it. I was going
to
say, whoa!
All right, so hold on a second. Wait. Rudy Boy Gonzalez, you are the commissioner of Texas Wrestling Entertainment, okay? I find it highly ridiculous and disrespectful that your so-called champion over there is sending threats to me. She's calling our voicemail and sending threats. I don't understand. Like, dude.
I love
it. You better sanction her. I want her suspended.
You reap what you sow, Dukester.
Give me a break.
I love how you licked him up.
You run your mouth, and eventually, hey, I can tell you from experience, you run your mouth, you're going to piss somebody off, and they're going to retaliate.
Well, I love how you run your mouth against Rudy all day long on Facebook, and then now you're appealing to him as the commissioner.
What?
Please help me.
He should
Please
do
sanction
job.
Her.
Listen,
out of here.
I'm afraid of her.
You're
okay?
Full of it.
She's tough. I don't
All right,
listen.
You know, we're going to move on to
don't
questions.
Don't hurt me, Micah. Don't hurt me, please.
We're going to move on to questions, Rudy, if you wouldn't mind chiming in, because, you know, Duke likes to give his input, which is worth zero.
Oh,
but
God.
As a professional and a legend in the business, it's nice to have someone that has some real perspective on our listener submitted questions.
Unbelievable.
So, thank you. The first question comes from Mr. Bertucci, and his question is, why do these old wrestlers think it's okay to talk down to the younger guys? Don't you think it's time for the old timers to give the younger guys some respect? Wow.
Ooh.
I did not know that was the tone of that, Rudy. So please.
Wait a minute. Bertucci?
Yeah.
Why does that name sound familiar?
Well, he's the guy that was mouthing off against the other big-time wrestler and got himself into a little, he built himself a little back and forth.
That sounds like Mr. Irvin Legend.
Oh, Jesus.
Yep.
Good luck. You know what? That guy has been you know, I don't. That's one of Duke's boys.
Yeah.
And you know, I have no problem with him. I'm sure he's a good kid. I'm sure he works hard. I'm sure he's this and that. But he hasn't done anything. He's done nothing to prove himself. So I mean, of course, when a guy like me that has worked, scraped, clawed their way, you know, and I'm not even saying I've been successful. I've just spent 30 years just doing this and just, you know, doing what I do and working hard at what I do. And then I see some little smart aleck, you know, trying to call out people and trying to, you know, that will rub anyone the wrong way. Anyone. So, you know, Mr. And then what kind of a name is Bertucci?
It makes me hungry, right? I mean, do you guys have Bertucci's in Texas? It's like a pizza chain.
What was that kid's name on Happy Days? What was Chachi?
Chachi.
What was his real name?
Baio, wasn't it?
No, but his
Oh, his name on the show?
Yeah. I think it was Bertucci.
Was it? I'm going to look that up right now. While Duke gives his answer to that question.
I think that it's disrespectful. First of all, here we have a guy who says, I wasn't successful. I've just been in the business for 30 years. You're only one of the greatest trainers of all time, and the fact that you're still wrestling, that you're a pretty successful guy.
What does that tell you then? After 35 years, and I'm going to sit here and say, well, I haven't been successful, that means that I've had a huge piece of humble pie given to me somewhere down the road, and I understand how this works. How would you like it? How would you feel if I said, hey, my name is Rudy the Legend Boy Gonzalez Bull something or other? How is this kid going to call himself a legend after 6 months of wrestling?
Because he's that good. Because he's that good, obviously.
Well, I mean, you know, I suppose there's a certain, you know, you want to have confidence, right? But you don't want to have maybe overconfidence.
Listen, you fake it until you make it.
And there's cockiness.
Well, that's the thing. I mean, faking it till you make it is one thing until you get your ass handed to you when you're not expecting it by someone who's been in the biz. I don't know. I'm going to take Rudy's side here just because he's against you, Duke. So, you know, no matter what, it's really right and wrong.
Let me just say this, and in all seriousness here. Rudy, you know that Urban Legend, a.k.a. Mr. Bertucci, he plans on invading Texas at some point. Soon. And I'm just telling you right now, you're the commissioner of Texas Wrestling Entertainment.
Here we go.
If you think that, you know, he's nothing and he's a this and he's a that and he's not a legend, even though he tells you to your face because that's his name. If you think that you know so much, then why don't you have him come down to one of your shows? Because I think it's kind of crazy that you've been ducking this guy who's been calling you out for over a month now.
You know what?
I'm just saying. You're not going to insult our guests. I'm just saying here.
Rudy's made time to come on this show.
Rudy. 35 years in the business, big, strong guy, but you're ducking a kid who supposedly doesn't know so much, right?
I apologize, Rudy.
There you go on your misinformation, just like when you make your little Trump statements. You're misinformed. But Duke, I'll tell you right now, I have agreed to terms with Chachi Bertucci.
For the record, Chachi's last name is Arcola.
Close enough.
Okay, so something.
But close enough. He's a paisan. Anyway. Yeah.
So I did agree to bring him into to one of our shows June 10th in a couple of months, I guess. And I've got something for him. I've got a special chair. I've got a kendo stick.
Oh, Lord.
I have stuff waiting for him. So, you know, hey, I'm a guy that gives opportunities to whoever, you know, whoever asked for him. And you know, he sent me some messages. And obviously, you see the stuff on Facebook. So I said, okay, you know what? I have a show June 10th. I'm not going to put him on one of my big shows in San Antonio. He's got to earn that spot. So let's see. We'll see what happens.
Well, Mike, before we move on from this very bitter discussion, I just have to ask, do you have a special chair Duke could sit into?
Because
that would be amazing. No. I would pay to see
call my
that.
Lawyer.
Yes, it's a chair, and you put like a little leather strap around the head, and you plug it in.
You know, don't mess with Texas. That's legal down there.
Listen, move on to the next one. My goodness here.
All right, next question is from No Cell Ivy. And No Cell Ivy asks, Duke, I have a technical question I hope you can shed light on. I hear people who are in wrestling schools say they're going into training, while others say they're going into practice. Which is it, practice or training?
Well, it's definitely.
Hey.
What?
It says,
Duke, hold on. I'm going to answer this question because it was addressed to me.
Here we go.
Okay? you know, when you go to wrestling school and you know, you show up, you're going to practice. That's the whole point, because you're going to practice the move. You flip around and you do all that stuff. It's called practice, just like any other sport or what have you, okay? So no cell Ivy. Yes, just to dispel any myths that are out there, it's practice.
This is not going to go well. Rudy?
Wait a minute. No cell Ivy. Where do you get these names from?
Thank you.
No,
welcome to my universe.
Those are our listeners. Those are our listeners. Don't disrespect our listeners like the Boston Bad Boy does. Go. Well,
even the NFL, even baseball has... What do they call that before the season starts? They have spring
training. I'll help you out there. Spring training.
You.
Yes.
Well, NFL has the
training
the
camp.
Exactly.
Yeah.
If you want to practice to be a wrestler, you can do that in your living room. I think Duke does do that.
I do.
He probably does. He probably thinks he's the African American Ric Flair.
Well, Scoot Andrews is, but I'm number two.
At the Texas Wrestling Academy, you train. You can do all the practice, doing all the moves you want to try and do, but you have to train to learn how to do those moves properly. You have to train to have proper body control. You have to train to have that balance. You have to train your mentality. It's not just, you know, okay, grab the guy by the head and flip him over. That's not wrestling.
Yeah, it's
training. You train to be an athlete. Do you have a? They have this thing called tough mutters. Do they do practice?
No, nope, they train for it.
Or do they train? Exactly.
They train for it. If you go into the CIA or the FBI, you don't go to practice to shoot your gun. You go to training.
Well,
exactly. you go to learn a skill.
Semantics.
Semantics.
Obviously, what the heck? What are you guys? Obviously, you can call it whatever you want. But if you want to be proper, if you want to sound like you know what you're doing, if you want to sound like a professional. I train guys to be professional wrestlers. I don't practice them to be professional. We're not in a play. We're not in a movie.
Oh,
we're
man.
Practicing.
Yeah, Rudy, I agree with you. Duke has just gone completely. He's so full of himself with this one-year show. He's completely lost perspective. And the fact that he's going against what you're saying is totally nonsense.
So, man, the internet will put anything on for a
give me a break. Give me a break.
I bet you that pregnant giraffe could have his own podcast.
Oh! Well, you know, I think that the giraffe got a lot of views. If we could figure out how to get that going on this show,
we might have to get a giraffe.
We'd be onto something.
See, get on that Boston Bad Boy.
All right, so Rudy, I've got a question for you. Why do so many wrestlers feel that the only people that can critique wrestling are people who wrestled or people who work in wrestling?
You want to know my take on it?
Absolutely.
Is I know exactly what... we'll put it this way. You want an opinion? You ask me for an opinion on something. I give it to you, and then you go and ask. Let's say you ask Duke for his opinion. Who would you be more apt to listen to?
Oh well, I wouldn't trust Duke's opinion on what restaurant to eat at. You know, like Duke, should I get the Mugu Gai Pan or should I get the Poo Poo Plat? I don't even ask him that. So when it comes to wrestling, I have to agree that I'm going to ask somebody who's had years of training and who's had years and years of experience because they're bringing something to the table.
Thank you. Exactly.
It's all theory and conjecture when it comes to Duke.
I'll say this. When it comes to politics and all that shady business there, I do tend to listen to the Dukester, but when it comes to wrestling...
Yeah.
And, you know, it's just, I see what he's saying. I just, you know, keep scrolling down Facebook.
It's like someone asking me, what did you think about the Apollo 11 mission when they were coming in? I don't know. I don't know anything about it. Why would I comment about it?
Well, first of all, I know about wrestling because I've watched it my entire life. So that's number one.
That's like saying you know how to skydive because you saw someone else do it.
Sure.
I can get up there and jump out of that airplane and survive.
No, but
You should try it.
I think that you guys are taking the wrong tone with our great listeners here. First of all, Rudy Boy Gonzalez, just because someone has never taken a bump before or has never, you know, held an announcer's mic before for a wrestling company, that doesn't mean that they don't know something about it or have a valid take on it. I mean, Jesus, you've never played in the NFL or the NBA, but I know for a fact that you give your opinion on that every day, whether somebody asks for it or not. And sometimes it makes sense. So what's the difference there, big time?
Enough of that NBA stuff. The other night I was arguing with the guru herself about man-on-man and the triangle and that type of rhetoric that the Spurs were playing on the Memphis Grizzlies, and I knew exactly what I was talking about. I knew exactly what I was talking about.
You know why? Because you don't need years and years of training and experience to know how to play pickup basketball and understand the basic rules of basketball and the basic penalties of... So you can comment on something because anybody can learn that in an afternoon and be able to say, hey, that was right, that wasn't right, that looks good, that doesn't look good. When you're asking about something like wrestling, which is so involved with both the front end and the training and the athletic part of it, you're way out of your depth when you're commenting
on
it because you're
looking
at it through a television.
No,
it's
not
going
to take
when I see a wrestling match, I watch the fans in the background. I watch, you know, I watch. I may find somebody in the background in particular that I watch. I listen to the commentary. I watch the guys. I see the whole picture. I don't see, the oohs and ahs like everybody. You know, the cool moves and I don't just watch that. I see everything. So when I see maybe someone like that, that very talented, she has a bright future in this business. What is her name? The girl that, I mean, she's a big girl, but I mean, I don't understand how Charlotte missed her doing that.
Oh, no. We're not going to do that on this show. We're not going to put Nia Jax over on my show, pal.
Nia Jax, Duke still wants to say Charlotte. She didn't catch up. The girl is 300 pounds. How can you not miss her?
Well, there you go.
All right. You know,
you just got handed some truth there, Duke.
No, he's out of his mind.
Listen, Rudy is, when Rudy's watching wrestling, he's forgotten stuff you didn't even have a chance to look at.
Give
That's how
break.
Deep he's
oh
looking at
God.
It. It's just like a sixth sense.
I'm going to tell you something about Rudy. Until he can beat the guru.
Oh, here we go.
And free throw shooting. He has no business talking about basketball. And some of the things he says about wrestling, I don't know, too many, you know, chair shots or whatever. I don't know what's going on with this guy.
Before you get yourself killed, I'm gonna switch gears a little bit here, Rudy, because I want your opinion on something that's legit. And we've been talking about this for a couple of weeks now since it happened. So the basic question is, do you think that pro wrestling has a bullying problem, a hazing problem? With the news with Mauro being bullied by JBL, allegedly, there's speculation that some of the higher-ups at WWE are okay with it. They condone this kind of environment. You worked there. You know JBL, right? And that's why we want to get your take on this, if you want to give one.
Okay, that's a good subject because, I touched on this earlier on my Facebook. But this is all joke aside. Wrestling society, the wrestling guys and stuff like that, and our group of people. How can I put this? And I know it's not going to come out the right way, or it may not sound the right way, or it may not make sense. But we're a group of guys that have a different way of seeing things. What other people may think is, man, that's stupid. That's insane. That is perfectly normal to us. Like, I put some examples on my Facebook. Would any of you guys drive to Walmart 5 hours away to work an 8-hour shift for $10 an hour?
No, of course not. No.
Of course not. So why is it perfectly fine for a guy to drive 5 hours away to work a 10-minute match and make maybe $50? There's nothing wrong with that. That's a guy trying to make something out of himself. That's what I'm talking about. It's with the concussion issues that are going on and guys, whatever. Why are guys, instead of easing back on the abuse on their bodies, why are guys doing more abuse to their bodies? Why are they going instead of pulling back? Why are they putting themselves more at risk by doing some of the stuff they do?
So you're saying that guys are going into this with eyes open, that they know what they're getting into because it's a hard business. You're saying they know it's a hard business from the get-go, and they know that it's going to be tough. Tough, just the word tough. Everything's going to be tough.
Sure. And guys, like I mentioned a few days ago, when I broke in, the guys that were in the business were men. Today, the guys that are getting into business are kids. And I didn't mean the guys that were getting were men, as in 40 years old or so. They were 20-year-old guys. They were, you know, but they were tough. They stood their ground. There wasn't really bullying as much, and we never called it bullying. They were pranks. They were ribs. Stuff that we did. Let's say, for example, I saw a guy nail Cowboy Lang, who was all of 4'10" or something. Nailed his cowboy hat up on the wall, like 6 feet up on the wall, and it was just out of reach for Cowboy Lang to reach it, and he had to go out to do his match without his cowboy hat, which back then, your outfit, your gear, and everything, that was all of you. And, you know, if you do that today, that's you're a bully. You're an ass. You're, you know, that's not right. But back then, that was everybody in the dressing room laughed, and, you know, it was. And no one said, "Oh man, that's not right, man. That's not cool." It was just having a good time. It was funny.
I never was really into teams. I didn't play a lot of team sports, but I understand that this must go on in any kind of team sport that exists, and that's men, women, whomever. There is like you said, there's that back room, there's that locker room, there's a bond that's created. Everybody's busting chops, you know. But my question with this is, we're dealing with one of the announcers. We're dealing with somebody who's sort of front office, kind of more front office than athlete. So is there a line between what you guys do as locker room guys, as the athletes, the guys going out there and then going back and blowing off steam or whatever, and this guy who doesn't really have necessarily that mentality, doesn't hang with that clique of guys, taking the abuse that he's not expecting, that's not what he signed up for necessarily.
Yeah, I mean, I get what you're saying. I know, you know, and I know there's the mental, you know, the mental illness part or whatever.
Sure.
Involved also. And I
mean, like when you were in your heyday of being involved with WWE, when you're all hanging out and you're doing your thing, did it ever cross over to the announcers, to the other support staff, you know, that this kind of, you know, pranks and things like that, or was it kind of contained amongst the guys?
It was contained amongst the guys. It was, and that is another problem that the guys today. I shouldn't call it a problem. I don't know. It is because when stuff happened in the back in the dressing room,
mm-hmm.
it stayed in the dressing room. And we, if it wasn't right, if somebody did go too far, then somebody said, "Hey," there was always that peacemaker guy. There was, you know, the muscle guy. There was Manny Fernandez. You know, I know for a while. In the dressing room at WWE, I hear it's been said it's been the Undertaker. You know, there's always that somebody that says, you know, enough's enough. And whatever happened, I mean, I could sit here and tell you guys stories on end of stuff that happened in the dressing room where you guys would be like, oh man, somebody should have called the police. This should have happened. That should have happened. But it didn't. It was a rib. It was a prank. It was hazing. It whatever. But you know, when it happened, it happened. And then, depending on how the guy reacted, that's how he was accepted. If a guy came up and said, "Hey man, that was cool, man. I'm gonna, next time it happens," then he got ripped even worse.
Right.
Until it got to a point where, you know, all right, you got me. That's cool. You know, haha. And then it's done. All right, he's not going along with it no more. That's where you get the term, you know, the guy's not putting it over, or, you know, it's just a different world in the wrestling society, I guess. I almost want to say, because I've never been in an NFL locker room or a baseball team locker room. I've only been in football locker rooms. I can tell you it happened once in high school, happened in college, where one of the guys that nobody liked because he was slow running laps. In high school, it was one of the guys nobody liked because he was slow running laps. And he always managed to, like, not do the proper weight training, or he was late to this and missed doing that. And so somebody put a big gob of Tiger Bomb, or what was it called, Icy Hot, on his shoulder pads and in his jock strap. And then, well, when he was in the middle of training, in the middle of football practice, there he is, you know. And he figured out that he needed to either step up or just quit the team, because the guys were, and I never took part in that. I watched and I laughed about it. But he figured out, you know, well, maybe I'd better start shaping up. And he did. And he no one ribbed him or no one messed with him anymore. And he gained a huge respect from all the guys. And I've seen guys in a wrestling locker room that have gone through stuff like that. And it's not, we've never said, you know, oh man, oh, that guy's a bully. It was just seeing where this guy was mentally, if he was headstrong, and go from there. You know, I mean, there's some things that you can do. Like one thing that I'll put this out there. One thing I used to do was I'd take Duke to go eat after a show, and Duke says, "Hey, Rudy, I'll go ahead and order me a tea or whatever. I'll be right back. I'll go to the restroom." He goes to the restroom. They bring his tea. I pour half the bottle of the half the jar of salt in his tea, stir it up, and just sit there.
That's a classic.
Oh yeah, and then he takes his first drink. Blah, you know, ah ha ha. Am I being a bully? Oh, I'm messing with him. You know, because it happened to me many times also.
Well, I'm curious. Do you think that's still a method though that can be employed? For instance, if you know, you're a parent, if it was one of your kids that came to you that was on the whatever team at school, soccer team, let's say, and oh yeah, they did some pranks to me, and yeah, and you say, okay, well, and then it doesn't stop, and they're having a hard time adjusting. They can't focus on what they're supposed to be doing. What would you tell someone?
Talk to them.
You go tell them to go talk to the person who's doing it.
If that happened to my son, and I do that, and my son did play football, and you know, if there was another player or whatever that was poking at him, I tell him, Steve, go up there and talk to him and tell him, do you have a problem with me? And maybe the guy doesn't realize he's starting to cross the line. Maybe it's just ha ha to him. Sometimes you don't know that. Let me put it this way. When it comes to this JBL thing, I don't think John Layfield is doing whatever he does to be a bully. I think it's a ha ha thing. I think guys now are just so, they're just so sensitive. You know, like I forgot who it was. I said something about a guy's style of wrestling, and then he messaged me. I can't believe you're making fun of my art. What art? You're flip flopping in the ring, and he made a big deal about it. And I even made the point to say, hey man, I appreciate what you're doing. I like what you do. It's just not my cup of tea. You're making fun of what I do. You're making fun of my art. Yeah, that's just wrong. That's unprofessional. I just said it's not what I do, and I don't, and none of what you do makes sense to me. You know, and he got very offended, and that's how guys are now. If back in 1984 or whatever, I would never walk up to, Bobby Duncan and say, hey man, because back in the day when if you had a bad match, guys, you know, if you did something goofy in the ring when you got to the dressing room, hey, Rudy, what was that? Were you trying, what was that go behind? Were you trying to hump on him or something? Or what, you know, guys would make fun of, and it wasn't that they were trying to be mean. It was just they're sending the message of, you know, you need to learn how to do this stuff correctly without saying you need to learn how to do this stuff correctly. You know, I don't see. And this is from someone from the inside that's seen a lot of stuff like that. Like, okay, well, another example is I did a match one time, and one of the first people I'd look at would be Manny Fernandez. And so I looked at him, and I said, well, how was that match? And I said something like, how did I do or something? And he looked at me, and in all seriousness, he goes, you know what, you need to just get dressed, go buy a ticket, go buy a bag of popcorn, sit in the front row, and learn how to wrestle. Just watch the matches. And a 20-year-old kid, you know, and that's the raging bull. I looked up to him. I still love him to death. That just crushed me. That inside. You know, and I was like, man, maybe for a second I thought, maybe this just isn't for me. But then I said, what did I do wrong? What do you mean? I got a chair, sat next to him. And then he went into, okay, when you do this, don't do that. When you do this, don't do this. When you don't do this, don't do this, blah, blah, blah. So now he fast forward to you know, 15 years, I guess. A few years ago, I did a show, and he was at one of my shows, and this guy came to the back, and he was huffing and puffing. Hey, Manny, see my match? And Manny looked at him and said, you need to get your stuff on, go around the front door, buy a ticket, get a bag of popcorn, sit in the front row, and watch the matches, learn how to wrestle. And the guy was, the guy just went off. He was like, well, who the F do you think you are? What do you mean? What, don't disrespect me that way. And he went off on it, and we started laughing. I laughed my ass off because, and he looked at me, he was like, what are you laughing about? I go, dude, settle down, settle down. He goes, F that guy. Who the, who do you think he is? And I'm like, well, that's like one of the NWA tag team champion guys. You know, that's Manny. I don't know about who he is. And he left, and then and Manny was laughing his ass off too. He's like, what's wrong with that guy? I said, man, you know these guys now. They're just so, they're not, they're just so sensitive. And that's what I think a lot of guys are. They're just sensitive. They're, don't critique me. Don't tell me anything. Don't, you know.
Well, the question is, I wonder, you said, you know, just going back a little bit, when you said if your kid was having a problem, you'd say, go talk to the guy, you know, confront it, you know, he'll see. What if that doesn't change it? What if your kid goes and he talk, well, Dad, I talked to the guy and it's still happening. Now it's happening even worse, and weeks go by, which I think is a almost probably a better analogy to what was happening with the guys in the WWE in this recent, you know, issue that we're talking about. You know, does, if it keeps going and nothing gets resolved, and the guy said, hey, knock it off, stop busting, I'm trying to work here, I'm trying to do this, I get the fun and games, but enough is enough, and it keeps happening, what is your recourse? What do you do when it's interfering with your work? Do you think it's just that the person should walk away from their career because they can't hack it, quote unquote, or do you think there has to be some other way?
I think if this was going on, and if the guy would have told JBL, pull him to the side, hey man, I don't appreciate it, da 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 da, whatever, I would think he would have stopped.
So you think that didn't even happen? You think there was probably not a conversation?
I would like to think that that's what would have happened. If he did do that and it continued, then go to, I mean, JBL is not the owner of WWE. Go to somebody else. Go to HR. Go to Vince. Vince McMahon has an open door policy. And I know some people say, well, he encourages it. But I think if you sit down with him and say, hey, man, I already talked to John Layfield. And I told him to cut his shit out. And it's, you know, this really bothers me. I have this deal and it's not, I really can't deal with it. And I think something would have happened. Going on the internet and making a big deal about it, making it bigger, that's breaking one of our codes. That's, you know, and as shitty as it may sound, as shitty as this may come out, you know, there's unwritten laws or whatever rules that we have. And some guys still follow them. And, you know, I don't get, sure, like, somebody told me a while back, we're talking, and they're like, you know, there's things that you can do. You know, you can do whatever you want in this business, but why do them? If you know there's going to be a problem, if you know it's wrong, why do you do it? You can do whatever you want, sure, but why? I don't know the whole situation on that. I really don't. I do know John Layfield. We're not best buddies. We don't barbecue, but you know, we have talked and stuff. And you know, I just don't see him, you know, saying, hey, well, you know what? You don't like it. You got a problem? Screw you. Do something about it. I'm gonna still rip it because I just don't. He's just never come off to me that way.
And you know what, Rudy, that's a fair call out on your part, because you can only speak to what your personal experiences are, number one, within the WWE, because you worked there for a long time, and also with JBL, because you've known him for decades. So it's not like you're some guy off the street who doesn't know the players here and the allegations and can't speak to this. You've been in locker rooms more than half your life, and you have perspective. So I definitely want to give you, we gave you that room just to explain that, because it makes sense what you're saying there from your perspective. I got to throw out something from my perspective. And, you know, folks say, yeah, this is Duke Loves Rasslin. We have a good time talking about pro wrestling and what have you. But I have a lot of experience in management, both from a business standpoint and also from a political standpoint, you know, from a government standpoint. And, you know, part of my experience is literally advocating for people who, for whatever reason, at least at that moment, can't advocate for themselves or they're having difficulty doing so. Everything from, you know, children who are being discriminated against or bullied in school to our elderly who are going through the same thing and everybody in between. And not just the workplace, but anywhere, whether they go to a business establishment and they experience these things or, you know, like I said, school or the laundromat, whatever we're talking about here. Unfortunately, these things happen. And that's why we have laws written a certain way to address these issues. It's compounded when you're talking about somebody who has a disability, whether it be physical or mental. We start getting into some weird territory there, and I call it weird because not everybody understands what the laws are.
Sure.
The WWE as a company, and they're a publicly traded company, they identify themselves as an equal opportunity employer. And this is on their corporate website, folks, and I'll post it on the Duke Loves Rasslin Facebook page just so you can see. This is from their own, this is what they identify themselves with, as it's not my opinion. But they identify themselves as an employer that does not tolerate and is free of, you know, various forms of harassment that include sexual harassment, gender harassment, age discrimination, and they actually identify bullying. And they identify anything that interferes with a person's normal ability to do their job, that's not something that they tolerate as a company. And I point that out because if these allegations have any iota of truth, where you have a situation where somebody like Mauro, who is very upfront with his challenges from a mental standpoint, I believe the man is actually legally disabled because of his mental challenges. If he's upfront about that and you still have people potentially putting him in a position where they're interfering with his ability to do his job because they're picking at him or, you know, they're doing ribs that he's not really in on, you know, some folks may think they're joking around, but he doesn't think they're joking around. And it doesn't matter what anybody else thinks because that's what he feels. When you got a person who already has challenges and now you're putting that on top of them, you're putting yourself in a bad spot and you're putting the company in a bad spot. And I don't know. I wasn't there. Hopefully the WWE is investigating the situation. If it's true, hopefully they take some corrective action and do some retraining of anyone that's drawn a paycheck from that company because, quite frankly, this is not something that they can afford. You only have to look at Fox News and what's going on with Bill O'Reilly right now to see a situation where you have a culture of any form of harassment that gets a little out of hand. And maybe one person's interpreting it one way, but person on the receiving end is interpreting something totally different. It gets out of hand. And now the company has to make some serious changes because things have gotten that far and they didn't do something about it sooner. So my point is, mental health specifically, telling somebody who has mental health challenges, hey, you got to toughen up or you got to talk to that person. Or you got to do this. Putting the onus on them. That's like telling a person with no legs, you got to run the race. So what? You don't have legs. So what? You still got to run the race. I mean, you know, there's certain things that are out of certain people's control. And whether we like it or not, or whether we're used to it or not, when you're working for an organization that claims that they understand and respect these things, everybody at every level has to abide by that. Because I'm sure they sign off stating that they have to abide by that. That's in their contract. There's no way it's not. Which is the reason why the company makes it public that these are the rules and regulations. This is their literally their business code of conduct. So I got nothing against JBL. Listen, I've been watching that guy since Global Championship Wrestling. Enjoy his work. And I got nothing against Mauro. Enjoy his work as well. But I'm telling you right now, WWE, and this is me being serious here, please, I beg of you, if there's anything like this going on, fix it. Fix it, fix it, fix it, please. Because you can't be talking about be a star and then you have this type of stuff going on. just doesn't work.
And if I can just jump in real quick on that, I think that was, you know, right on. You hit the nail on the head. But I also, you know, it's easy to vilify somebody, right, who is from a different, from an older system. The world is always constantly changing. We've changed so much from 30 years ago, let's say. Even 10 years ago, the world has changed so much. We've learned new things. We've learned that this is not a good way to run a business. We've, you know, it might have already always been known, but it's become codified. And so I think when you have people who have not been adapted as quickly, it creates a troublesome situation here. So like Rudy was saying, I think he knows the guy. I don't think the guy's any kind of villain. I just think it's a matter of didn't change with the times, maybe didn't understand fully what he was dealing with, didn't understand that, hey, this is how we've got to adjust things so that we can, you know, this guy who has an issue and we have to be cognizant of that. Like you said, if it was someone without legs, it's pretty obvious. But if you have all your body parts, it's not obvious necessarily.
True.
So, you know, I think that it's complex like that. It's not, I don't think there's a villain here. I don't think necessarily, you know, I think that It's the learning curve is steeper for some people than it is for others. And some people get hurt along the way, which is unfortunate. But I don't think that means it's the wrong way to go necessarily.
True. And it's a complex situation. And I agree with you 100%. And I respect and appreciate Rudy giving his perspective, because once again, this is a guy who's there. This guy who knows, you know, certain parties involved here potentially, and hey, you can't buy that kind of respect.
No, and Rudy, I'd love to get, like, you give you the last word on this.
No. I don't know. I guess let's just see, because I will say that not everything you read about, you know, or that comes out public is, mm-hmm. in fact, fact.
Exactly.
You know,
yep.
You know, so, I, you know.
It's hard to comment when you don't know all the facts.
Exactly. So I'm just taking, like, a wait-and-see attitude.
Sure.
You know, I mean, if John did something wrong, then it'll be handled. It may not be handled the way we think it should be handled, or some people think, maybe some people are calling for his, you know, like there was a Raw, I don't see Raw, but I heard there was like Raw the other night where there's a big chant, you know, fire JBL or something. I don't think firing him would be the answer.
There's a bigger problem than just, you know, one or two individuals. This is, we're talking about culture. We're talking about company culture here.
I think John is from the old school, and he still sees things that way. And there's a lot of older guys like that are back to Michael Hayes, Layfield, you know, Undertaker. A lot of the older guys still look at the wrestling business from when we broke in. Some are more outspoken about it. Some are just they know that there's been changes, and, you know, but they're set in their ways anyway, you know, and they handle things a little bit differently. So, you know, my take on this is just, you know, it's just to see what happens, you know. And I hope everything works out. I know it will, as a matter of fact. And then just move on.
Good call.
It's just another learning, you know, process here, you know. And again, just like you said, this business is changing. It's evolving, and that's part of the evolution, you know.
Good call. Good call. Listen, Rudy, I didn't mean to take you down such a serious path there. You came to celebrate.
We all know how you are. Dude. So,
you know, well, it was nice to have some legit perspective from somebody so long in the business. So I really appreciate you
Absolutely.
Diving in with us on that a little bit, so we could touch on it,
Rudy. Anybody out there wants to check out Texas Wrestling Academy and get some training from a world-class trainer, literally the trainer of champions.
That's right.
You know,
emphasis on training.
See what I mean? The title isn't the practice guy.
Hey, take it up with No Cell Ivy. Don't take it up with me. Take it up with No Cell Ivy. I'm sure you know her.
Wait a minute.
I'm sure you know her.
No Cell, wait a minute.
Big fan of our show. She, in fact, she's been on the show a couple times.
Has she? How? Wait a minute. What are you talking about?
Listen, I'm sure you'll figure it out. How can fans get in touch with you there, Rudy? Now Rudy doesn't know people
now
anymore.
His up is down now.
Yeah, his up is down now. How can folks get in touch with Texas Wrestling Academy?
Texas Wrestling Academy is on Facebook. You can also go to Texas Wrestling .wordpress.com, and you'll get all the information on Texas Wrestling Entertainment and Texas Wrestling Academy. We are endorsed by WWN, which is with the Evolve company, all that. I mean, if you want to be trained properly and taught the business properly, and at the same time get a little thick-skinned, the Texas Wrestling Academy is where you want to be at.
Yeah, Rudy.
And they get a special. I hear they have a special chair for Duke when he comes to visit.
No.
So we're going to be coming down there at some point this year.
I'll stand. Don't worry. His name is Rudy Boy Gonzalez. He is the trainer of champions. Listen, Rudy, I'm gonna put out an open challenge. I want you and Irvin Legend to come back on the show late May.
Yeah.
And we're gonna do an official debate. Leading up to your event, where Irvin Legend is going to be on your card, since you're saying that this is official now. So we're going to have the both of you come back and do an official debate. Do you accept the challenge?
A debate about what?
Middle East policy and foreign trade. What do you
think? He's gonna come to Del Rio, Texas. He's going to walk into the dressing room. I just may have him carry my bags.
Gonna make a legend carry his bags. A legend's gonna carry your bags.
It's one thing to call yourself a legend. It's one thing to call yourself a legend. It's another thing to be a legend. Thank you, Rudy, for coming on the show today.
Thanks, Rudy.
Guy, I have a couple of minutes, real quick.
Yeah.
Just maybe a minute.
Yeah, go ahead.
Duke, congratulations on 1 year. Your 1 year having this podcast. That since the time I've known you, you've become a great friend of mine. We've had lots and lots and lots of discussion off to the side about personal issues, and I don't share my personal stuff with anybody. And I want to tell you that I really do consider you a great friend, and I hope that your podcast and Boston Bad Boy and all this stuff goes on to bigger and better places. I wish you guys all the best. And, you know, good luck with what you have. In my opinion, I told Duke this before, Mike, this is one of those podcasts where there's no real drama on here. There's no bad mouthing. It's just something you like listening to. The air about it is refreshing. And like I said, I wish both of you guys, and I wish this podcast the best of luck in the future. And, this is your 1 year, and I hope you guys have many more years to come. Thank you very much for having me on.
Rudy, that's awesome. Thanks so much,
man. Thank you, Rudy.
I really appreciate that.
Wow.
No, he hung up on
Did
you.
He really?
You know what? That puts a fine point on it.
Yeah.
That man knows how to do the end of an interview, right?
Yeah, he knows how to walk away.
That was nice of him.
It was. Wow. It was very special. And listen, Rudy, you know, you're a friend, and listen, man, we really appreciate you. It's always no holds barred. You know, and that comes from mutual respect, because he really took the gloves off and gave his honest opinion.
Yeah, no, and that's the thing. You know, we always talk about our show, and when we're planning the show, and all kidding aside, you know, we put a lot of thought into how we want to do it, and
absolutely,
to have somebody of his caliber recognize that. Again, I'm not the wrestling expert. For the most part, I hate wrestling and I hate the fans even more.
Okay.
I really feel that, you know, it's so cool to have one of the pros give us a nod like that.
Especially, I mean, you know, he's literally the trainer of champions.
It only took a year of you dragging me through this with these people and the group and all of this to finally get a little accolades for myself. So, it was a long time coming.
You know what, Boston Bad Boy?
Yeah.
Speaking of which, I got something special for you.
Really?
I do.
Wow.
Because you've been given so many gifts today.
Well, you know, that's what I do. I provide.
So I'm going to provide you with something because I don't want you to feel left out.
Yeah.
So we got one more message in the inbox.
Okay.
And I'm just going to just play it. Here we go.
Hey, Duke. This is Dingo.
Okay. Wait a minute. Dingo?
Hey. You play that message. That's Dingo.
You're going to come on this
your
show.
Your friend Dingo.
You're
going
to come on my show.
Yep.
You're going to come on my show.
Your show. Oh, yeah,
your show. And bring Dingo?
Dingo.
Dingo, of all people?
He's been waiting all year for this moment. Don't ruin
this.
This is exactly right.
Listen. And that's my point. Dingo
special.
Needs to get a life.
No, it's something
Dingo needs
special.
To get a life.
Dingo forever on Twitter. And on behalf of Dingo Jr., the Coffee Corps.
That's right.
Why is he bringing Dingo Jr. into it, by the way? What does that have to do with anything?
Dingo Jr. is a star. Dingo Jr. is a star.
I hope he has more sense than his old man. Let me just put it to you that way.
And myself, I want to congratulate you on your podcast.
That's right.
Duke Loves Rasslin.
On your podcast. Where's this guy from?
He's from New York.
Jersey City?
Listen,
he's probably from New Jersey.
He's congratulating me.
Oh, please.
Rasslin, and your one-year anniversary. Your success is attributed to you and you alone.
Oh, come on.
As that anchor of a co-host, the Boston Bad Boy
Boston
contributes
bad boy.
Nothing.
Oh, Boston.
Nothing.
Boy. What is this, Andrew Dice Clay? You hired him in here to come in?
Nothing, okay? Listen, he's a smart man.
Oh,
listen,
please.
To him.
And for the life of us, we don't understand how you have reached the heights of success that you've had with that rude Boston bad boy by your side.
Of course he doesn't understand. You know why he doesn't understand? Because he's never reached heights of success.
No.
He's never reached the heights of success that I have.
Listen.
He's never spent more money on spilled liquor than guys like him made in a year.
Give him a break. Play what
he's
saying.
Give me a break. You're going to this guy follow me out.
He's very foolish.
Yes.
And he will learn my name. Because
his
he dared.
His name. He goes by the name Dingo.
Learn his name.
Why do I know his stupid.
Learn his name.
Stupid.
No.
Childish.
It's a great name.
Asinine
it's
name. Dingo.
He named it after his dad.
Listen,
his dog. It's a great name.
If he sounded like Paul Hogan with an Australian accent, he sounds like he's from somewhere outside on the New Jersey Turnpike.
You're out of your mind.
He's named Dingo.
Leave
what does he know
alone.
About dingoes?
Play what
he's never
saying.
Even been to a zoo.
Disrespect me.
That's right.
He disrespected my son.
Yes.
Oh, please. You know what? You got to earn respect.
Hey.
You got to earn respect, and Dingo's done nothing to earn respect.
The
now,
fact that his
Dingo
name is
Jr., it doesn't even come into this picture.
Well, we love Dingo Jr.
You know, that's a factor. We're talking about Dingo Sr.
Yeah.
Dingo.
Everybody knows you don't mess with a man's dog.
That's right.
Oh,
he drew a line in the sand.
Drew the line.
Wait, is he saying his kid's a dog?
No.
Is Dingo Jr.?
The original Dingo was the dog.
The original Dingo was the dog?
The original Dingo was a dog.
What happened to Dingo? Did he decide I couldn't live with these people anymore?
The dog is dead.
Because my owner's just crazy and I can't stand
it? I have a receipt with his name on it.
You see that?
He'll learn respect.
Okay, Dingo. How many times did you have to record that, Dingo?
Thank you, Dingo.
How many times did you
have
to sit by yourself in a little room with your little phone and record it over and over again because you were so you couldn't get it out the first time? Because I bet you wrote that for him.
No,
I bet you helped him with that.
I didn't have to. Yeah, let me tell you something.
You know, this is an anniversary show, and you got me all wound up now.
Look at
I had
you.
A great conversation with Rudy, and who took my side, and now you're going to blow this up with Dingo?
Let me get this straight. You play, like, 5 messages. And plus, Rudy plays one of people literally trashing me, and I got to take it all.
But
show,
you had it,
and you
but
get
all
one
the,
guy
all
calling
points,
you out, and you
all
got
the
a problem.
Points they make
you
are,
got one
real
guy
points.
Called you out.
They're real
okay?
points. Listen,
You're
all the points they make are real points.
Yeah,
Dingo,
oh, please,
Dingo. Talk about somebody who has no perspective
like
on anything.
I like Dingo.
Dingo needs to get a life.
No,
Dingo needs to go out
Dingo,
there
Dingo,
into the real world.
Don't get a
look
life,
at the
Dingo.
Sun.
No.
Come out of his mom's basement. Does Dingo still live in his mom's basement?
Listen.
He probably does.
Leave him
say
alone.
It.
No,
he probably
I didn't
does.
Say that. I didn't say that. Dingo's
You're
a grown,
about to say it.
He's a great man.
You know what? You people are listening, you can't see it, but Duke has written on a piece of paper that Dingo lives in his mom's basement.
Don't listen
to him. And he's holding
it
up to me right now.
Wrong. Folks, thank you.
Don't end the show on me. What's wrong with you?
For 1 year of fantastic greatness here. And guess what? We're not going to stop anytime soon. We're going to keep on going.
Why are you going to get me into a new year?
Join
like this
us
all wound up?
Next week, where we have the analytical cake. I want to thank Looney Lane. Thank Rudy Boy Gonzalez. Thank Double D Dave Davis. And thank all of you.
You know what?
Boston
I'm not even. I'm not even. I'm so
You need
wound
to be
up
nicer
right
to the guests.
You know, I'm taking a vacation.
Okay, Dingle's
you know what?
Yeah.
I'm not here next week.
You know what?
I'm taking next week off.
Are you kidding me?
I'm taking next week off.
No. You don't
I'm
get days off.